I've done a couple of these, not on the official Windship's tour that has a budget, but on our makeshift Windship tour. I've toured with band members such as Adela Najarro, and also with David Dominguez, my doppelganger. And I love it because we all have to read from the books, you know, have to. Francisco threatens our lives. So, I don't know if you ever follow anyone, we tell the same story. So this is David Dominguez, and I can tell a story where David Dominguez, after he graduated from college, he got his bachelor's degree in lit, which means that the only place he could work at is a sausage factory. And he always says, why can't you wear a ring in cold weather? You know, why can't you do that? He always tells the college kids, and they're like, I don't know. They're like, it's because the cold weather in the refrigerator will swell up your hand, and it'll cut off the circulation. The ring will cut off your circulation, and they're going to have to cut it. So that's the story he always tells before he reads this poem called Fingers. And you probably know where this poem is going. So this is about his time working in Marcoli sausage or Galdini sausage. Fingers. Because of the frozen meat and a silver ring, my index finger swelled and dimmed. The men held down my wrist and used a saw. I fought back the need to squirm and watched where the nicked up teeth missed, and the scars began to form. I remember the day Julio longed to go home. Nothing past time like work. Unconscious work when the bones pounded and the muscles stretched. So when the stuffer jammed, Julio jumped on a stool, lowered half his body into the machine, and when his thigh brushed against the go button, the blade moved an inch and sliced off his index finger. I wiped the blood and thought about Julio, how he did not cry out, how he asked for my smock and held his hand against his chest, how he pushed away those who tried to help, how the finger was never found. Most of all, I thought about myself. Would I have screamed? Could I have taken the pain, walked outside to the employee payphone, and, with good hand still held steady, dialed 911? So, to evidence how David and I are doppelgangers, I'm going to read this poem from the Date Fruit Elegies, which is the inaugural book from the New Poetry Series line from Bilingual Press, edited by Francisco Aragón. Thank you for selecting this. I'm going to read this poem. It's called These Hands, These Roots. And I find myself writing a lot about hands. I think it's because we have to watch our hand not write all the time. Working, again, with my father, we go to school, we're all nice and dressed, and our hands are all, like, crusted with dirt. And I remember one time one of the workers said, if you want to get chicks, you got to clean your hands. That's the marker. They know. They know what you do. I was like, really? I wrote this poem many years later. It's called These Hands, These Roots. See if you can catch the David Dominguez reference. Thank you. We didn't know about it. Go on, tell me. My hands look like yours. Nails clipped, filed, buffed, shined. They weren't always so. My hands were forged from gardening, working so deep in the soil they could have been roots. Fingers splintered by wooden rakes and shovels. Some gardener whose face and name get lost like loose coins in my memory's backseat told me women look at men's hands for dark half circles between their nails, which give away your blue collar status like a pair of torn jeans. No matter how handsome your face, I knew I had hope, but what about Lupe, whose mower chopped off his fingertips instead of blades of grass, who then preserved them in an ice chest next to some plums? So I scrub, clip, and lotion my hands with aloe, fearing bachelorhood and internet dating. I take pride in my hands now, but what about when the skin gathers at the knuckle and arthritis tangles my fingers for cracking my knuckles since I was 10. But until then, hold my hand tightly with yours as my other hand wipes the sweat from my brow under the perspiration of work and love and the fact I know no other way to wrestle out a life for us. When I wrote this poem, this was really before internet dating, so this is kind of about the revision process. So it was actually, you know, so I just put fearing bachelorhood and video dating. And then I had to give it time. But now, I mean, you, that's how we all get married now, internet dating. It's not even like a stigma anymore. I'm going to read, I guess, one last poem. I think my time is up. It's a little long, not too long. No, don't get scared. It's called Black Hair Lying on a White Pillow, and this is after César Vallejo's poem, Black Stone Upon a White Stone. And César Vallejo, in that poem, keep it short, sort of predicts his own death and envisions his own death. And many poets have written homages to that particular poem, so I decided to take a turn. But instead of predicting my own death, I kind of decided, well, what about the times when I was really young and I was very, well, I don't want to say I was very suicidal, but you know, you're 14, you're like, the whole world's against me, you know, and why was I born? I didn't have to be born, Mom. I wish I was never born, you know. So I kind of had these, like, pubescent suicidal tendencies. So I'm writing this poem, and as I'm writing it, I'm like, this is really ridiculous, John. I can't believe you thought this. So it just started getting more and more funny, right? I think that's how I dealt with it. But I particularly write this poem, or I'm going to read this poem because as a teacher, I've taught Yukio Mishima's Patriotism. I don't know if you know that Japanese short story, where the character performs seppuku, and he slices his stomach for his country, and his guts spill out. And it was really awkward was that I had a student who had suicidal tendencies and going through such stuff, and I'm like, shit, what a poor choice of but it was something I predicted. But we talked about it. It's good, because I always say that we have many taboos in our country, and one of them is we don't talk about suicide, especially writers, right? And many of writers have taken their own lives. Rest in peace, for example, David Foster Wallace. So black hair lying on a white pillow. I am 14 and I am dead. My body lies on its side as if napping during twilight. I am 14, and this is the year I was most likely to have killed myself. Self-esteem low as water running down a sidewalk. Ridiculed for my skinniness. Skinny because I could not help if a hot lunch was always a buck more than what I could afford. I would have probably taken a mouthful of sleeping pills, like a bunch of shelled sunflower seeds. Rather than using a gun, mostly it leaves a mess. A bloody diarrhea on a bedroom wall for someone else to wipe up. Or if I had carved my initials into my wrist, the blood would have frightened me into calling 911. Even if I couldn't use my fingers to dial, I would have tried with my nose, my tongue, or even my earlobe, only to reach, no doubt, a busy signal. It would be after dinner, after Dad came home from work, yelling at us like a coach for not watering the pots. After squeezing the clusters of blemishes like raspberries in front of the bathroom mirror, after asking Elisa Puerta for a date and her not even acknowledging I asked, it's not your sister, Javier, don't worry. Javier Puerta. It would be a Thursday. Friday would be too late to ask for a date. And that following Friday, I would be in the desert sun, somewhere after the front page but before Family Circus. And I would be the center of attention in high school for once, before I'm forgotten over the weekend. I would be remembered at a halftime memorial, football players holding their helmets over their hearts, cheerleaders holding my freshman photo over theirs, finally my face between their cleavage. At my funeral, my grandmother would weep. My grandfather, stricken with Alzheimer's, would believe he was dead and had forgotten to crawl back into the coffin. My epitaph would read, "Here lies John Olivares Espinoza, 1978 to 1992, born the same year as Superman the movie was released nationwide. Also died the same year as Superman, once being his hero." It would say nothing else, because I had done nothing else. God should send me now back into time to